Welcome to the Department of Renewable Resources Seminar Series for April 5th, 2012. Our speaker today is Dr. Ron Hall, Research Scientist with Natural Resources Canada, Canadian Forest Service. Today he will be speaking to us about integrating LiDAR and optical remote sensing for forest inventory in the Northwest Territories.
Thank you, Francis. It's amazing what a few donuts would do to bring a few people out on a real wet, snowy day. So thanks for coming. What I'm going to be talking to you about today is a project we've been engaged with for the last number of years with the Government of Northwest Territories to address an information need that's quite critical in the north, given the lack of access and vast resource distribution that they have up there. Before I start, I thought I would show the list of our project team, because you can't do a project of this nature without acknowledging some people along the way that's helping you out. There are a number of people from my staff, the Canadian Forest Service, and those from the Carbon Counting Team, people from the Northwest Territories who initiated the project with us, a number of others who've helped out in a number of ways, providing us with some forest ecology expertise and LiDAR data, as well as processing some of our tree ring cores, and some of our funding agencies, including the Canadian Space Agency, the Northern Oil and Gas Research Initiative, which provided some funding since some of our work overlapped with a portion of the Mackenzie Gas Pipeline and the Government of Northwest Territories. We've had a number of students and terms as well that's helped us out, and that's always very helpful when we're in the field. So where are the forests in the Northwest Territories? Well, it's quite broadly distributed, and the figure in terms of how much forest could be something that's debatable. Some of the reported figures, if you pull off the Canada Forest website, suggest that the forests are distributed over a landmass 33 million hectares in size. If you look at the satellite land cover map that's done up north, they'll say there's 40 million hectares. So there's probably some ambiguity that the actual number is somewhere in between, and knowing exactly how much there is hasn't actually been precisely defined. Much of it, however, in terms of timber productive forest, occurs within the Tiger Plains, which is part of the boreal. One of the challenges they have in the north is that there's detailed inventory data for less than 10% of the forest in the north. And what's there is quite dated. Some of it is up to 40 or 50 years old. So you can appreciate if that's all they have to be able to report on the status and extent of the resources, especially for indicator reporting, can be quite a challenging exercise. And that demand for being able to report on the status and health of that forest is increasing. The Government of the Northwest Territories has instigated a state and environment reporting requirement to contribute both territorially and also federally in terms of national and international support in terms of the state and the environment. And to do that, they have a real need for information. And recently, the Government of the Northwest Territories released a biomass strategy. There's a movement underway to reduce the use of fossil fuels and being able to help contribute to a reduction of carbon dioxide emissions by relying more on using green fuels, they call it, through wood pellets, creating a bit of a forest industry in the north. And so doing, hopefully they could offset and provide a bit of an industry up there right now. There isn't really much of a sustainable forest industry up there at the present time. In addition, the Government of Northwest Territories sits as one of the members on the Forest Sinks Table as part of the Canadian Council of Forest Ministers, where they would like to contribute information about the forest in the north to help assess whether the forest in the north is a carbon sink or source. The ability to be able to report on that is quite challenging just because there's a lack of information. And in this slide, and it's the best I could pull off because it's pulled off on the website, shows in the colors in the various colors where they actually have detailed inventory, which is mostly along major drainages, and of course, you know, mostly along the southern Northwest Territories, where you would expect most of the timber forests reside. And so that need to be able to report on whether the NTBT forest is a sink or a source is something that has a lot of interest from us from the Canadian Forest Service. We have a National Forest Carbon Counting Team led by Werner Kurtz at the Victoria. With the Canadian Forest Service, they report on the forested part of Canada that contributes into the Environment Canada reporting that goes as a signatory to one of our reporting requirements to the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. And therefore, there was particular interest to see if we can help provide a little more current information over what the inventory information that was available there at present. And that aspect, plus the National Forest Inventory reporting requirements, gives us a bit of a federal driver as to why we might be interested in participating or working with the Governor of Northwest Territories to help them in this context. So the goals of the project then is somewhat to help create an inventory program that would incorporate and integrate a satellite remote sensing component along with the existing NWT Forest Inventory Program that could help provide a spatial coverage that's inclusive of outside where they have existing inventories now. And in so doing, to help generate information that would be helpful for their meeting some of their reporting requirements. The objective to help meet that goal was to explore from what information we had available. One thing we did have was a satellite land cover map for the forested areas of Canada that I'll be talking about in a moment, produced for circa 2000, generated from Landsat thematic mapper data, and that was one piece that we had contiguous, spatially distributed across the entire Northwest Territories. So we could use that in some information base and then add in forest structure information, such as stand height, crown closure, estimate volume, biomass, and get some idea of age class distribution as something we can do with value-added attributes within this framework of satellite land cover. So it's not the kind of detailed inventory you're going to expect to see with a conventional forest inventory that you see down here, but something that would be conducive that we can undertake up north. Our approach then was, how do we undertake something over a landscape that's so large with so little information? Well, by integrating a judicious sample of field data and looking at satellite information from both from Landsat and from both satellite LiDAR data along with some portion of airborne LiDAR data, can we integrate these together and produce a vectorized map that would be similar to what a forest inventory map would look like? And that was what our approach was. The study area that I'm going to be reporting to you today is mainly this pilot area, approximately 51,000 square kilometers in size, where we developed some of our methods on our work, but actually we've been undertaking work over a much larger area, an 8 Landsat scene, 200,000 square kilometer area that we've undertaken some work along as well. So eventually what we will take is our methods and our protocols developed here, but extend them over this larger landmass, and we're very much along that pipe already. This is an encapsulation of where the existing forest inventory is now. Some of it is up to 1960s, which is, you know, more than 40 years old, and some of the most recent is down 2003. So they have quite a range with varying degrees of a level of specificity in terms of the inventory classification detail. The more recent stuff is similar to what some of you may be familiar with the Alberta Vegetation Inventory with species site and crown closure information, but some of it's more broad based on some of the older stuff that they have. So they've got a bit of a mixture done by a variety of consultants, and that's what they've had to go on. So our exercise that we were asked for is, could we blend into this and also compare how well our information would compare the information that they had. What we've also have newly access to, something that we haven't really quite fully explored yet, there was a boreal airborne LiDAR transect across the entire country of Canada, mostly along the boreal forest. The analyzers in red shows where the transect went. Don't ask me how the flight lines were decided, because I wasn't involved in that. But we just obtained access to this in November 2011. And so we've had to, in a sense, step back, be able to move forward in terms of some of the work that we've been doing, because we actually had airborne LiDAR over a portion of our study area as well, but because of the metrics we had to use to generate some of our stand attribute estimates and so forth versus what we're going to be getting access to, we've had to step back to move forward. But what this gives us is an opportunity to incorporate another sample of airborne LiDAR data that we would not have had access to otherwise. This was flown in 2010 and just made available to us, for example, just this last fall. The other aspect that hasn't been explored extensively is with a satellite LiDAR data called ISAT with a sensor called GLASS. And we'll be talking more about that in a moment. And it's a polar orbiting sensor, mainly for ice exploration, looking at sea ice depths and so forth. And because it's on a polar orbiting path, the paths tend to converge as you go further north in latitude. And as a result, you tend to get data that's closer together, so you get more footprints. It's a sampling LiDAR. It's a waveform. It's not the pulse type you get from the airborne. But because you get a lot more footprints, that gives us, in a sense, a lot more sample points that we can derive from and over our entire study area. So our exercise was, hey, how can we explore use of this, given that it wasn't really developed for vegetation height and forest composition and structure type applications? There's some of that work going on for sure, but that's not the motivator for why the sensor was developed. But it was a great opportunity trying to integrate that data source into that work. So I'm going to present to you a flowchart in a second. The flowchart breaks into four major parts, one part being the field data collection, second part being the land cover map. We had the circa 2000 that we started off from, and if we were going to build from that point, we decided we needed something more current with our other field data collection and other data sources we were using. So we updated that to one in 2007 by generating a new land cover map. And then our remote sensing modeling work, incorporating both an integration of airborne and spaceborne LiDAR, a space imputation process from those sample points, and then the mapping of site quality as a vehicle to how we're going to get at the age classes distribution, a little separate component that I'll explain. And then how we pull it all together into a vectorization process to create what we're calling a multi-source vegetation inventory. And then a small bit about some of our early results on a carbon counting pilot. So if anything we do from remote sensing, we can't go too far without some anchor from the ground. We need ground data to help anchor what we develop from relationships and models when we see from the image and from our LiDAR data. So we had a judicious sample of field data put in over a number of study areas over the last 4 years. And they were allocated according to a plot sampling protocol established by the National Forest Inventory, measured every tree in terms of height and diameter, and instituted a number of models to give us volume and biomass, put a bunch of tree core stuff to get us age data. And then we updated the land cover map using a little different philosophy than what was done from the earlier land cover map of Canada. We've sort of migrated a little different process that we thought was more progressive and more conducive of getting a consistent land cover for that area that we think had some innovation in that process. And then we pulled this together by pulling the ground and some stratification framework with the land cover to help look at how we relate stand attributes from the field plot to our sample of airborne LiDAR data. That gives us basically a calibrated set of models that we can then map our stand attributes over the footprint where we have airborne LiDAR, and we're going to use that to calibrate our satellite LiDAR. And you'll explain a little bit more of that in a little while. The other aspect was, how do we get at some idea of age class distribution in the north with just a limited ability to collect tree core data? And we've had this concept of mapping site quality, and where we implemented a physical fuzzy logic modeling process that I'll describe in a little bit. And then we pulled this into a vegetation mapping process using a bunch of GIS scripts and programs to produce a vectorized map from the raster data. Conventional field type data is acquired. You can read the list as well as I can. We certainly get the one of the most difficult perhaps might be the crown closure information, because there's always some ambiguity with that. We had 9 estimates of crown closure from a densiometer. Otherwise, we have a differential post-GPS, post-differentially corrected GPS for getting our positioning, and then all of our tree information that we would collect accordingly. And we would collect tree cores based on 5 cores per species per plot. So we had 2 species on plot, we would core 10 trees, for example. Plot size was 20 by 20 meters. That gives a bit of a configuration of what the plot looked like. And because some of the trees, some of the stands up there, there's a lot of small trees, so it would take forever. Some of the plots have upwards of 1,000 trees or more to sample. We instigated a subplot basis where 1/4 of the plot, randomly selected within that quadrant, was selected where we measure every tree 2 meters and taller. Otherwise, it was only 5 centimeters and taller that were measured for all the other trees, and we would just scale that accordingly. We had a bunch of tree age work. There's really absent information in terms of what the age data, what the age class distribution is in the north. And we thought if we could just even get some idea of that, we'd be further ahead than what we had now, because that's really important information to feed into the carbon counting models. So because of that, we felt that by collecting a number of tree core samples and developing models, that we can then apply an estimate of age to the total height of the tree. For every tree, so from a stand height classification from lorry height and taller is our definition for stand height. Then we'd be able to get an idea of what the stand age was, because we're after a stand age estimation, and then look at stand age to height relationships through stratification of our fuzzy logic model. And that was our approach for that. It's based on the notion that the relationship between height and age is linear for a given site index class. That was the basis of which we used to approach that process. A lot of this kind of work was supported and provided direction from the group led by Jack Batty of the Canadian Forest Service through Terry Vanderman Sanders and Catherine McNulty, who did a lot of the tree measurement work. So our basic question was then, what's the relationship between height and age by species, and then to stratify that by cytogenetics class over a number of areas. We sample a number of areas over the different years. We've done field data. That is about 960 tree cores that we use to generate our models. These were the formulations we use, basically scaling DBH age to the total age, and then break into a variety of cytogenetics classes. So we actually had a whole number of functions that were developed. Not the most elegant way of pursuing this, I'll admit, not the way we wanted to do this. We kind of explored some polymorphic cytogenetics functions, try to find some local indicator of site to try and pull them all together so we get greater strengths in our degrees of freedom and so forth. It doesn't work very well because there's not a lot of information that's very site-specific, spatially available everywhere, that gives information on what local site is. So with that, we just wasn't able to do that. And I had help from Valerie at UBC who was trying to advise me on this. And she tried a number of different functions and just didn't work very well. So we had to go through a little more cumbersome process than what I'd like to have used. The land cover map is a standard type of land cover map that gives us as undersupervised classification process into 23 land cover classes. Really what we were after for was to give us some idea where the corner for deciduous and mixed forest stands were. It's mapped to three classes of density, but we kind of parked that aside when we get the crown closure information from our modeling work, from our LIDAR data. It was just a means the way we can stratify our mapping process. So that was our basis of species. So we went down to the species level at the mapping polygon basis, but we were from our plot level data. One of the big things when you try to approach a large area land cover process is that when you have a scene-by-scene process, they tend radiometrically to look quite different from scene to scene. The difference is because of different dates in acquisition. We've got phenology effects, differences in radiometric effects, atmospheric effects. And so some of the previous work where you do land cover classification on a Landsat scene-by-Landsat scene basis is sometimes quite difficult to pull them together and create a nice, clean scene mosaic tile afterwards because you tend to get seam lines at the borders. So we want to explore an alternate process to give us a cleaner product. How we did that was we normalized that to a MODIS 250-meter image that's been atmospheric corrected and radiometric normalized across a whole large area using a process developed by the Canada Center for Remote Sensing. The process there is you see this normalized mosaic on the screen that gives a cleaner image to which to work from. And then from that HC mosaic is huge. And it's too large to submit into an unsupervised classification type process. So we need to parse it down. Rather than parsing it down by the scene tiles, we decided to use major drainages. Because then we use a natural drainage, we avoid the seam lines that will come up when we do the mosaicing of the classification afterwards. So we end up these basic five pieces where we took classifications individually and then pulled them together after that. A big source of information is where do you get the source data from in order to label your classes you generate? And we had to go through a bit of a collaboration effort. We did some work with Ducks Unlimited, who had a lot of air points and ground points up in that area. There was an ecological land classification work. There was a ton of photos and ground points done as part of that process. And then we had some field data points from the Government of Social Territory as well as our data. And that combined gave us local data to use to help us identify what the classes were. And the result is this is the land cover map and just some photos, for example, that gives you an idea of what we used to help us identify what was there. And that was critical in helping us to do our land cover work. Okay, the next part is we get into, now we have collected some ground data, we've done the land cover work. Now where do we go to get further information about structure? And realizing that we first explored actually the use of high spatial resolution QuickBird imagery, 60-centimeter panchromatic, 2.4-meter multispectral, looked at single-tree isolation and image objects from segmentation work. And the problem with that is that these high spatial resolution images are little 16K by 16K footprints. They're like postage stamps over a large area to map. So to try and extend that kind of data becomes problematic. And deciduous stands don't cast any shadows. So, some stand types are a little harder to map. We were first exploring a method developed by, it's done by over in Finland and then adapted over in northern Quebec. And they have a lot of open black spruce stands with strong shadows that can be cast because of the reindeer lichen in the background, so shadows show very nicely. But we got a lot more than just black spruce stands in the Northwest Territory, especially part of the boreal. So we had to go through another route, and we took advantage of an airborne flight of airborne LIDAR going up north, and we flew an area where we had ground data, and then that was our basis to expand from there into satellite LIDAR. So our airborne LiDAR that work was done by the College of Geographic Sciences over in Nova Scotia that was doing work in the north. These are the specifications for it. The optic LiDAR is a pretty common sensor. It was flown, we had a portion of area flown that we then processed into a bunch of metrics that we overlaid it with our ground data to generate our standard attribute estimates. And I can talk a lot more in detail about that. I just want to make sure I get through a large number of slides that I have. This gives you some idea. This is just a stand height image composition that's pulled together. You know, obviously, what you get from airborne LiDAR from the high pulses is a point cloud. And then from that point cloud, as you see here on the right, this is like the ground data here and some various levels of canopy returns. Use the very metrics that gives you the proportion of returns off that canopy to use as predictors to our stand metrics. And this gives you one example here of height. One of the interesting things about this, and this is something I can show a little later, but I thought I'd throw this on top, because if you were to look at the LiDAR data generated on the left, what we tend to do is we process the point cloud under a raster cell to 25 meter pixels, so you generate your models on that cell size. So then you get pixel estimates basically of your stand attributes of interest. So in a sense, when you overlay the inventory polygon, you actually can get estimates of variability within your inventory polygon. So if you look at a standard forest inventory where you get one single value that applies for that single polygon, you actually get a bit of a diversity. And there's a lot more things we can do beyond that, but it was just the idea that you see a lot more inherent variation in your forest stand as delineated than what an interpreter is typically able to identify. And there's a number of reasons for that that I can certainly expand and get into. The other aspect, and what we had this attributes mapped from the airborne LiDAR side is, okay, that was just our vehicle to be able to apply an estimate where we don't have ground data to apply that over to the ISAT LiDAR. And what we had was the NASA ISAT glass that had been processed to different versions that they have put out. They have come out different paths as each time they come over. So there's a variety of different versions in terms of processing software and paths based on dates of acquisition. So part of our learning curve was processing all that data to get a subset that we can make use of. What we do find is that because as the paths are converging as we go further north, we're getting that data that's separated along a path that's about 7 to 10 kilometers apart along the path, 170 meters apart along a single path. So we're getting increased density of footprints that are normally 65 meters in diameter. It's normally a shape of an ellipse. Depending upon the date of acquisition, they do vary. Some are circular, some are ellipse. That caused some interesting challenges in terms of how we process the airborne LiDAR to get estimates within the shape file of a ISAT footprint. But that was what we were working with to be able to estimate stand attributes at those values. That sensor is no longer in operation. It was functional for getting vegetation data to about October 2008. So it was no longer, it's been decommissioned in 2010. ISAT 2 is coming out, so there would be a replacement sensor with slight improvement on the specifications, be out in the approximately 2016 timeframe. I think a satellite LiDAR sensor offers us tremendous opportunity in the forestry domain, particularly if we get in a more northern forest, in terms of the attributes we can generate from that. But one thing is free. There's a lot of people that are very strong technical people in terms of processing and correcting of these data, so we can get it in a form that we can use. So I think because there's a lot of expertise behind it and the cost is right, when we go to areas in the north where we can't afford to acquire things like airborne LiDAR data over vast expanse of forest, it offers us a data opportunity. So what we have in this case is we determine above the certain noise level where the top of the canopy measure would be, and we take that to where the bulk of the returns are, and that difference there is the total return of time that gives us an estimation for height. So what we have is a variety of metrics that we use to estimate the height, crown closure, volume, and biomass. Once we have that, then we have basically a set of point estimates throughout our landscape. Our next stage was then how can we get this into a spatial format? And what we explored was the use of a k-nearest neighbor spatial imputation process, using some of our parameters specified there, using the red near-infrared shortwave infrared channels from Landsat TM, the compound topographic index generated from ArcGIS. These are the initial four channels, four dimensions we're using in our spatialization process based on the nearest Euclidean distance of the 10 nearest neighbors of our points. And that generates a point estimate of those values, and then we can just carry that right across our entire image. So what we then have is a continuous model estimate of each of our attributes. And these become different data layers. And we're going to be exploring some other parameters that's listed there. This gives you one example as being total volume, and that's just classified for the sake of thematic display. All right, let's park that for a second. Let's look at this issue of site quality and how we were trying to approach the idea of looking at height age models. One of the issues that we had with approaching conventional site indexes is that we've got to know for a given point location x, y, what site index function to apply. We often don't know that because we don't have other in-situ data to draw from. So we approach this process based on a couple of papers that suggest that the relationship, for example, between height and age can be expressed as a function of biophysical site properties as developed by or reported by U.R. Ung. And Daniel McKenney, in one of his papers, developed some spatial models of site index based on climate and soil properties. So using that kind of construct as a science foundation, we employed the use of an ecology expert, Dave Downing, who'd done the taiga plains and taiga shield ecozone maps in the north, revised and did a lot of groundwork up there. He became our source of expert knowledge to help us develop some spatial models approaching this mapping of site quality as our proxy for productivity. What it requires then is a variety of input layers and using of expert knowledge to develop what we call membership functions. And the membership functions are just a way of coding expert knowledge to a set of rules that if you're on this cover type and on this ecoregion, on this geology type and on this CTI and so forth, then site quality is this. So, and there's a bunch of if-then rules and set of a block that creates up these translation of the linguistics of the rules I just gave you. It goes into a rule block process, then you can process and close that and produce an output that then you can translate back into a set of classes that gives you a thematic output. And when you what you call defuzzify back, you get a map output out of that. And there are rules of confidence you can get out of this as well, by the way, that we're also working on. But that was our vehicle to try and get some idea of what site quality was. And that gives you this map over a 10-class display, and that's just an arbitrary classification to give you an idea of the diversity over the study area, the larger area, actually. Once we had that, then we actually parsed it off into three major classes by species, and we then looked at overlaying that, it was like a stratification mask, overlaid that against our distribution of ground plot data, and look at the relationships between height and age. And it gives you some examples on the bottom. So that gives us a rough estimate based if we had stand age or stand height, which we do have from our LiDAR data as mapped out over our surface. We can get some notion of what stand age would be. All right, so now we have that, and we have our other stand attributes. Now, where do we go to actually create the map product? And we had all these raster layers of information that's not terribly conducive for spatial analysis and hard for those in the natural resource community to easily use. So one of the new things we tried to do was how do we create a vectorized forest inventory map that would give us a data set that a forester or those in the natural resource community would be able to easily use. And so how we did that was by looking at the foundation of species coming from the satellite land cover, and then reclassing, dividing a common legend that we can simplify down from the forest vegetation inventory in NWT, a classification of our remote sensing based estimates into something common so we can merge the data set together. And I'll show that in the next couple of slides. But if you look at how a forest inventory polygon is generated, it's typically defined by some combination of species, height, and crown closure. So if that's the primary components of a stand polygon like we do in inventory, we use something very similar in this case here. So we created a height class and crown closure class and then the species and pulled that together along with a bunch of other classes to create this inventory map and then vectorize that. The process here is that we actually have a satellite vegetation inventory from all our modeled estimates and those continue to be available to us. In fact, we're going to create a vectorized version of that as well. And then we have the forest vegetation inventory over a portion of the area, as I shown earlier. Our initial work was to combine the two. The rule was if there was existing forest inventory, you kept it. And therefore, that overtook where we had satellite inventory to create the first vectorized map that we had. We're going to follow back and create another version, which is the satellite data. This gives you what the class structure is. The forest vegetation inventory, as stated, is very similar to the Alberta vegetation inventory with species site and crown closure, and then a variety of other classes that we pulled in. The satellite vegetation inventory is beyond the species, is a modeled estimate of height and crown closure, wetland treed, that we wanted to get standard attributes for, a number of non-forest classes, and as well as the wetland classes, and then some of the open shrub classes and so forth. And what we do then is brought that together into a common legend, so that then what we have is a raster base from 1 to 48 based on each of these two layers into one layer, and then we would vectorize that. And we had a bunch of rules and so forth. And like, for example, a minimum polygon size of 2 hectares and adjacency of neighbors and a variety of other things like that in the GIS set. The vectorization process is basically where we have bring in our, another way of visualizing this was bringing our primary species of height, crown closure, and species into our 48 class structure. We would then, because what we're going to have is a very pixely type output. So we have to sieve that, and generalize that, get rid of the minimum size pixels and so forth, so we create a little cleaner process, merging both the SVI and MVI, and then running a set of rules or a set of programs with using scripts in Python and AML to create the vectorized product. And what we would then have is a polygon with a set of attributes assigned to it, both the class attributes as well as the modeled attributes for each inventory polygon. So within the polygon attribute table, you would actually have a record set up of record identifier of each polygon that had the string of attributes associated with that. And that kind of format is then somewhat similar to what you would see in a conventional forest inventory map in GIS form. Okay, so we took part of that in the little pilot area and say, how can we use this now into a carbon counting exercise? And the primary question we wanted to answer is the forest and also territory a common sink or source? And what we had is what the data does the carbon counting team have now? Well, what they basically have in the north is that generated from CANFI. CANFI is Canada's forest inventory, summarized of inventory records on a 10 kilometer by 10 kilometer cell, extremely dated and quite broad, and no spatialization. And that's the data they had to work from versus our data that we used and from the MBI, and then we want to do is compare them. We actually also want to bring in the SBI. We haven't done that exercise yet. We brought in one disturbance mechanism as being fire. The H-class data that we used gave us the data for what the inventory was current. It was about 2008 or 9, somewhere in there, and we dated it back to 1990, as well as their data back to 1990, and then the carbon budget model grows to stand to get the carbon pool allocation so they can get the estimates and distributions accordingly. The motivators we felt was that this gives us a first-time opportunity where we can actually integrate data from a multiple set of sources between field and LIDAR and satellite into generating an inventory map that could provide information that could be used into a carbon counting exercise. And it was viewed upon as perhaps the only mechanism by which we can get full coverage of a large areas where trying to conduct conventional forest inventory with aerial photography is just going to be cost prohibitive and just not going to be possible. So what we have in CANFI is a grid cell data set. U-curves were brought in from Alberta. North Territory doesn't actually have U-functions to work with. And the core cell data, as you can recognize, creates some uncertainty in terms of trying to bring in the aspect of disturbance in terms of area burned. We brought in disturbance, we know how much area that's burned. We can bring that in from our remote sensing data set. But in the CANFI side, they just look at a random selection of inventory records by each CANFI cell. They add them all up till they get the total amount that doesn't exceed the total area that's burned. And that's why some of the areas becomes a little bit different. The big limitation with that, you don't actually know what records, what stands to actually burn in that type of application. The MVI, in this case, was using inventory polygons derived from both the NWT, forest vegetation inventory, as well as our remote sensing-based satellite vegetation inventory. We used the same yield curves that selected from Alberta, because there was none that's up there. And we applied this over this existing pilot area, but our intent is to extend this work over the entire 200,000 square kilometers over this next year coming up. This gives you one result that gives you the differences in age class distribution and shows some marked differences. The Canfi data shows a lot greater amount of mature stands and tends to be bimodal. The remote sensing data set, as we scaled up, has a bit of a peak here, but a more widely distributed age class distribution that we perceive from the base of people we talked to up north seems to suggest it's more realistic. We need to do further validation of that work. But certainly that differences in age class distribution has a profound effect in terms of how the carbon pools and allocations from the parameters that get generated. This is only a very small subset of results that was created. And you can see some differences, for example, in the heterotrophic respiration and the net primary productivity being higher in CANFI versus in NBI, largely because of that greater age class distribution, but bringing more mature stands at the top of the yield curve, for example, versus what we had in the NBI. But we look down below, you know, the burned area came out to be roughly the same. The total inventory is about the same. There's a difference in emissions that was estimated. And I think largely because of that older stands, you know, greater biomass, greater potential for emissions from greater volume of biomass of trees than what you would have had if you had a younger class, age class distribution, for example. So if in summary, if you look at the two, though, you would look at that and say, well, overall, you would conclude that regardless of inventory data source, the NWD forests, at least for that pilot region, are both, you conclude, the same, would be a carbon sink. But the biomass density is quite different. And if I was looking at meeting some of their future policy requirements in terms of this bioenergy plan that they have coming up and so forth, I would rather be conservative than overestimate how much biomass carbon stocks I think I have up there. So there's, depending on what your purpose was, and decisions you want to make, there are some different ways of how you can look at the results that are generated here. So in conclusion, we've had a way that we've integrated different data sets into this mechanism generating this inventory, a data set that provides a combination of both. I'm going to be very interested to see what would happen when we only look at this from the satellite remote sensing point of view, because I think that picture might change, and how does that compare, and that's going to be part of our exercise. The fact that some of the inventory data is really dated in the north, I think would cause some problems, some of the decisions one would make from that process. The carbon counting exercise decisions, the conclusion we make is roughly the same, but definitely we're going to be continuing that work over this larger area. And of course, we have a variety of work that we're continuing on with. The big one is continuing this exercise over this larger area that I showed you earlier on the slide. We want to validate the stand attribute estimates in greater detail. We haven't had an opportunity of doing that yet. The airborne LIDAR data, the transit from across, is going to give us that opportunity. Because once we identify where the conifer deciduous and mixed polygons area are within that transect, a portion that will overlay with the satellite LIDAR data that we can use to calibrate and validate our satellite LIDAR estimates, as well as our airborne estimates, and allow us the ability to get some error bars around that so we can look at air propagation effects and look at some of the uncertainty estimates going across that we just haven't had a chance to do yet.